and we are here today in the PEN America offices interviewing Chinese writer, poet, and filmmaker Tang Danhong. Tang Danhong made a documentary film in 2000 called Nightingale, Not the Only Voice, in Chinese, Ye Ying Wu Shi Wei De Guho, which is one of 20 films included in the Guggenheim Museum's Documentary Film Festival, Turn It On, China on Film 2000 to 2016-17, curated by Ai Weiwei and Wang Fan. The festival continues from mid-October to December 16. You can find out more information, including the program on the internet, at guggenheim.org, guggenheim.org/turniton. Tang Danhong's film, Nightingale Not the Only Voice, follows the lives of three artists, including hers, on their shared journey through what transpires to be some personal and psychological trauma on the road to self-discovery. Tang Danhong examines her past, particularly her relationship with her parents, and looks at the painful formative moments that inform her current life and art. In the final section of the film, she confronts her parents about her father's abuse of her and her mother's lack of support. Welcome to PEN America, Tang Danhong.
Thank you.
Can you tell me about that final scene, what it was like to confront your parents, and then maybe talk about the life that you had led up to that point that made you feel like you needed to do that?
At that time, I was deeply depressed, and I was talking to my psychologist, and I got the idea that I want to turn the camera to myself and listen to myself to understand what made myself to be so depressed. So during the process, I made the connection to me and my, there's some trauma that's connected me and my parents.
Describe that feeling that you had. I think you were a writer, you were a poet, but you were blocked, right? You felt the words weren't coming, you couldn't express yourself.
Yeah, at that time I was a poet and I wrote poems, but there were so many censorships, not only political censorships, also self-censorship. Like, it is forbidden to criticize your parents. It is that's in our culture. Respect.
That's not the law, but that's just society around you. Yeah.
Right. So all the, although I wrote about pain, about sadness, that it's like you filtered all the important source.
Right.
And so it's become kind of empty and meaningless. So. But I tried, that part is during the editing, actually, before I didn't think about to ask my parents. I just spoke to my psychologist and I thought the film would be finished that way. But during the editing, I just suddenly said, I must ask him why he did that to me. I must ask him. So
you're making this film, and through the process of making this film, you realize, I've got to confront them.
Right.
I've got to find out.
Right.
Yeah.
And I thought I could get some answer from them. So, but it came out that my mother repeatedly, like usual, like before, she just justified my father. And the moment you can see from the film when she heard what
his explanation when you confronted him? What, how did he explain why he did what he did?
You mean after he beat me or stopped me?
After he beat you, but also later. How did he explain
he
himself?
He almost never explained. Always my mother. She's the one who come to me, sit down with me, and sounds very gentle with a kind of love, and explain to me why your father did this to me, because they want educate me to behave properly, and in order to become a good person, and all this is because of love. So it's convinced me because I really believe it. I just try to manage to understand the logic. And
so it's very hard when you know somebody's
child,
expressing love
right.
with pain.
Right.
With,
so yeah. as a child, it's just make it connected to the directly, like the love is reduced.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very very confused.
Yeah.
So for many years, maybe. Really believed that it's because of love, but still, you know, it's a trauma, so it will always attack you in a different way. Yeah, the pain will attack you in a different way. So
all these years later, when your mother sees the film and she reads about it, and she obviously feels that she needs to give you more of an explanation
right.
about who they are, why they are the way they are.
She
said, What does she do?
She sent me this letter and told me what she experienced when she was a little child, and with many kind of small details that shows that she remembered many things when she was very little. And then, but in the letter she told me she would tell me all the stories of her own life in order to educate me, to make me understand how to grow up and to be an educated person and a smart person. But the letter that she's, the story that she wrote to me actually just stopped here. She couldn't make any progress. She just like, it's like she got stuck and
right.
blocked because I was waiting for her to tell me more,
right.
but no more, until now, no more. So, and before it was also quite painful to me to remember my previous life, I mean before I left China.
What do you mean by that, your previous life? Do you feel it's a different life?
Right,
yeah.
I think that Danhong also seems like that. Yeah, so now it's a new Danhong, I think.
Right.
So I also was difficult to me to face to those that life. So I started to continue to think. I just
So this was in 1951, so a couple of years after the new China was formed, right?
Yeah.
Under the rule of Mao Zedong and the Communist Party,
yeah,
right?
It was 1951 was the year they started a political movement.
Right.
It's called the Land Reform Movement.
Right.
And
what was the purpose of the Land Reform Movement, tell our viewers?
The regime just wanted to change the whole society system, yeah, and take all the land from every individual.
Right, so they want to seize the land from the landowners and redistribute it, right? So tell us about your mother.
During those few months, it's just like 6 months or something, about 1 million landowners were murdered, including my grandmother's family, because this is a landowner family. So all my most of the family members of my grandmother, her sisters, sister-in-law, brother-in-laws, were during that time were murdered. And my grandmother, she was the only one who survived. And the reason that she could survive because her elder daughter, my mother's elder sister, hid her in that place. And my mother, she mentioned her family. She almost never mentioned her mother and her. She, after that, actually, she had a close relationship with her mother and with her little sister. She and also in her whole life, she almost never mentioned them. And also in the film, you can see the model that she likes to talk to me is always like justifying herself,
right,
or justify his, her husband and her father, or justify the country, party, made mistake. So I try to understand what is that. So I think it was like she died when she was 12 years old, and when she saw all these things happening to her, and she was really terrified, and she wants to survive, so she tried to believe, and like it's justified everything in order to make herself to believe what happened to her and what happened to her family is kind of like sounds like they deserve it. That's also kind of a way that she made me understood like they deserve it. Like,
so she had to adopt the thinking of the party that was doing it.
Right,
she had to adopt their judgment.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And it's like I used to say she was eaten by zombies.
Yeah.
And it turns her into a zombie.
So everyone becomes a zombie. Otherwise they don't make it. They don't get along with the people around
them.
She
must participate.
Right.
And become part of that.
Right.
Part of the group who murdered her.
And for you, as an artist, as a poet, as somebody who wants to speak and write authentically, what you truly, truly feel, this is not something that can work, is it? To live the way your mother lived, to adopt that point of view, how do you then be an artist in that environment?
I'm not like from the beginning I start to rebel against it. I tried my best to believe, and I tried to be part of them. Not only be a good kid of my parents, also try to be a good student in the school, and try to
there's domestic violence and parental abuse of children and punishment is not unique to China. It's something that we have in Europe and the United States and all over the world. What makes this story unique to China? What about it do you think is different from all of the other families and children who are being abused around the world? Why is it different in China?
I think, anyway, my family is, our family is not the only case in China. In China, the society is full of this kind of family. So if I see my parents, to me, it's like they create a dictatorship bubble in this small family. And
like a tiny dictatorship,
right,
in the family.
And the family, my father, who's the ruler, and he's a dictator. And my mother, she's in charge of propaganda and brainwash. And this small bubble, if full of the society, it's a giant one. So I think actually it's become a kind of social ideology. And this ideology is the base that how the dictatorship could succeed in China. And it appears as Communist Party, the party. So now some people they criticize the communism regime, but for me I think this is not only come from communism.
So it's not just a function of communism.
Right.
It's something deeper.
Yeah,
something.
It's also from the culture.
Right.
Culture, and it has existed for thousands of years.
It's a remarkable story, Danhong. I'm almost speechless listening to you tell it. And I want to thank you for coming in today to the Pan America offices and sharing this story. And we want to close our session on Facebook Live today by saying that Danhong's film was part of Turn It On, which is a documentary film festival on China from 2000 to 2017 at the Guggenheim Museum. It continues through to December 16. There are films like Danhong's that really penetrate into some of the really difficult subjects. And in one aspect, a lot of these films and works are hard to look at, they're hard to confront, but they are films that we must confront, because we're hearing voices through these films that need to be heard. That's very much what Pen America and Pen International is about. If you want more information about Pen, Pen is the premier organization working to defend freedom of expression for writers, poets, artists, and filmmakers like Danhong in the world. You can find out more information about Pen America at pen.org. Thank you so much for joining us today, and that's it for us today on Facebook Live.